legend. Many know him as the former Member of Parliament for Kwanza Constituency in Trans Nzoia County, and also a former minister who served in various capacities in both the government of the late Daniel Toroitich Arap Moi, and also during the time of the Kibaki administration. He has also been very pivotal in shaping some of the most important coalitions in this country that have shaped the history of politics in Kenya. And we're also talking to a gentleman who many do not know that he has another side. He's a professional veterinarian. He's also a farmer, and he also has a strong passion for sports. So who am I talking about? We join him at his home in Trans Nzoia County. I'm talking about Honorable Dr. Noah Mahalanganga Wekesa. We meet him tonight to just find out the other side of him and what he has been up to in his retirement days. Thank you so much, sir, for having us tonight.
Thank you, Serfine, and your team. I'm delighted to have you in Trans Nzoia, and we talk about life.
All right, we are happy to be here. I want us to start way back.
Yes.
The young Noah.
The young Noah was born in Kakamega County, a place called Luandeti, which is in Lugari constituency today. I went to school in a primary school there, 1946, before your mother was born. And I proceeded to Chevaiwa Primary School, where I was for 5 years. And I went to Lugulu in 1953 for Form 1. We call it Form 1 at that time. And I did 3 years at Lugulu, and I did another 2 years at Kaimosi, from two and three, and then from Kaimosi I finished my second school at Kakamega in 1955 to 57.
Mm-hmm.
We used to have an exam called the Cambridge School Certificate, and you had to pass in first grade to go to Makerere.
Mm-hmm.
All the African schools did not have facilities or did not go up to university. You had, all the Africans had to go to Makerere to do the 2 years to prepare them for degree work. So if you pass in first degree, the first division in the Cambridge School Certificate, then you got a place in Makerere. It was not easy.
Were you in that list though? Did
yes,
you make it?
Out of about 55 or 56 students in Kakamega in my year, I think 6 or 7 of us managed to go to Makerere.
Mm.
I wanted to join veterinary medicine, so I had to choose 3 subjects, biology, physics, and chemistry in Makerere.
All right.
And I finished there, and I got a scholarship to go to Edinburgh University. Why Edinburgh University? Because at that time, in 1959, when I finished in Makerere, or 1960, when I finished there, there was no degree being awarded by the East African University at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to apply to go to Scotland, to Edinburgh University, to get my degree in veterinary medicine.
Yeah. Let me take you back a little bit. Before you went to Scotland, what made you choose, you know, veterinary medicine as your career path?
I suppose I looked for after cattle for a long time, and and I went to school when I was like 9 years.
So you were a herds boy.
I was a herds boy, and my interest was just animals. And people said, why veterinary? Why not dentistry? Why not medicine? I said no. Mimi nataka kuwa daktari wa wanyama.
Mm.
So I got a scholarship.
That opportunity, how did it come about? Was it easy back in the days? Was it easy for an African, you know, boy to get such a prestigious opportunity to be enrolled in an international university?
I'll tell you what happened. There was a facility by the Kenya government, the scholarship. A lot of people at my time were going to India, they were going to America. But if you pass very well and you went to Makere, you had an opportunity to apply to go and do with government support. So I applied for a scholarship. And luckily enough, the Masinde Muliro was the chairman of the bursary fund at the time. Mm-hmm. And he knew me very well. Not that that's why I got it, but it was just a coincidence that Masinde Muliro came from Trans Nzoia, and I also came from Trans Nzoia. And of course, I won the scholarship to go to Edinburgh University.
All right.
So I went on a government scholarship.
All right. They describe you as a man of many firsts, you know, being among the pioneer African veterinarians in that time. You were among those. In fact, your office was the first in Nairobi. Yeah. Just talk to us about, this must have exposed you to very big names as clients, and you served the late president as well, Daniel Toroitich Arap Moi, during your time as a doctor.
Uh-huh,
yeah, tell us a bit about that.
Yeah. Well, I qualified in 1966 as a veterinary surgeon. I decided to work in Britain for about 6 months, and when I came here, the Minister of Agriculture hired me as a veterinary officer, a field of veterinary officer, and my first posting was in Olkalau, Nyandarua district, and I went there for about 7 months, 8 months. I worked with leaders such as J.M. Kariuki and other leaders at the time. From there, I was transferred to Homa Bay for about 7 months. I was in Homa Bay. They transferred me to Kisii in 1988, and I was in Kisii for about 1.5 years working as a field veterinary officer.
So you spent the largest, amount of time in Kisii County during that time?
Out of my 3 years in government, I spent 1.5 years
in Kisii.
And I was promoted to provincial veterinary officer. And therefore, my station changed to Kisumu. I was provincial veterinary officer there for about 3 months, but I decided to resign. The reason being that I was getting these promotions coming very quickly. And being a provincial veterinary officer, I was doing a lot of administration.
But who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want to be promoted? I mean, everyone wants to go scale the heights and go higher as fast as possible.
You're forgetting the fact that I went into veterinary medicine because I loved working with animals.
Oh.
I like healing animals. Now, being a provincial veterinary officer, I was going to do administration.
So you're in the
and
office.
Soon they were talking about, you'll go to Nairobi in headquarters, labda utakuwa director or veterinary assistant director. And I said, wait a minute. Mimi nilienda shule kuwa daktari. I do not like to do administration. Mm. And because of that, I resigned.
So what did you do after that?
I resigned to come to Kitale, where we are.
Mm-hmm.
I came to Kitale in 1969, November. I remember the date very well. Mm-hmm. I resigned exactly 3 years after working for government, because we were bonded to work for 3 years when you are on scholarship,
mm-hmm.
3 years in government. So I waited till my 3 year term was over, and then I resigned on 3rd of November 1969, and I came to Kitale. Why did I come to Kitale? I had a visit of three people who came to see me in Kisii. This was Masinde Muliro, Wafula Wabuge, and the late, both of them are late, and also the late Pius Gumo, who is the father of Fred Gumo.
Fred Gumo, yeah.
Who was once a member of parliament for this area and also Nairobi. Those three elders came to me and said, look, things in Kitale are changing. Many Africans have been given government facilities to do farming there. They have farms, they have livestock, but they don't have a veterinarian. Mm. So why don't you come and do veterinary medicine there? So it was that, very easy.
That's how you transitioned
to come here, and I started my practice here. But one of the important things, and I know you want to ask me, is that up to that time there was no African veterinarian in private practice. Noah Mahalanganga Wekesa was the first to venture. Because we used to be told that, oh, to be in private practice, you need a lot of money, and you have to be a Musungu, you have to be
connections.
I said, wait a minute, me, I'm going to be.
You dare
so
to dream.
I came here hardly with no equipment, but with my knowledge from school, and I set up my practice here. I found there were two veterinary practices in Kitale. One doing Saboti and the other one doing Cherenganye. Mick Jacob, who went to Edinburgh University with me, my own university, was doing this area. So he was very excited to have a
colleague in the profession.
A colleague here. Mm. And Bagno, Dr. Bagno, a lady, she was doing Cherenganye. So they accommodated me. They said, you can set up practice. But Mick Jacob was very accommodating. He said, Wekesa, in about a year's time, I'll be giving up my practice and I'll hand over my clients to you.
To you.
So very soon, I was already taking over the clientele of Mick Jacob, who was the veterinarian for this area.
So you came back to Kitale to explore what was your passion. You wanted to test the waters and try to expand the horizon when it came to your passion. Tell me a little bit about how that connected to the Noah Wekesa, the farmer that we see today.
I worked 24 hours sometimes. There were three practices here, and one of them, after about 6 months, Mick Jacob left. So I had the whole area, and in another 6 months, I think, within a span of a year, the other veterinarian also left. So I had the whole county, as we call them, districts in those days. Mm-hmm. I had the whole district as a private practitioner. So I worked night and day. Mm-hmm. It was very exciting.
The demand for your services was too much.
Yes, I was very excited. I worked with large animals, mostly dairy animals, which are predominant practice here. Dairy, there was a bit of horse work, dog work. My clientele was all Muzungu. Of course, Africans had taken over some of the Muzungu farms here, but they didn't know when to call a vet. So my clientele, 90% were European. And it was very exciting experience. I found myself deep down into veterinary medicine, and I loved it. And I did that for about 6-7 years here. And then things changed in terms of the clientele. The government decided that for Europeans, if you wanted to farm, to continue farming, you became a Kenyan citizen. Or else you have 10 years to sell your farm to government. That affected my practice.
That ultimatum.
Yes.
You have 10 years to sell your farm.
It affected my practice. So a lot of young farmers who are Mzungus decided to leave. They didn't know whether Kenya was going to be what it is today.
Yeah.
So a lot of them sold their farms. And then by 1974, most of them had sold out. And also my practice had come down because now the farms had been taken by Mwananchi.
So the clientele is dropping.
And Mwananchi didn't know when to call a vet. So my practice was going down. So I said, wait a minute, what do I do? I've got small children, they're going to school. So what do I do? I said, I'll go to Nairobi. So I identified a practice in Westlands. Phil Heath was the owner of this practice. Mutiti Mpaka Road. Those who are in Nairobi, they know exactly where my practice was. So I went and bought the practice in 1976. The first African to come with his dog, that my dog is sick, was the late Kirubi.
Miss Kirubi?
And I said to Kirubi, is this your dog or what is this? Because the people who bring dogs to me,
they're not Africans.
They are cooks and drivers of Africans. I have never seen an African like you coming with your own dog. He says, I love Alsatians, I love dogs, and this is my dog. So, you know, Maremu Kirubi was actually my first
African
client that I met in Nairobi.
Wow.
Of course, now it's different.
All right. So during this time, there was something again about Dr. Noah Wekesa. You have such a strong passion for sports, and tennis is one of your favorite. You even went all the way to chair the Kenya Junior Lawn Tennis Association of Kenya. You must have been very good to be given such a prestigious position.
Yeah.
So tell us a bit about this.
My interest in tennis was because of my children and because of myself and my wife.
Yeah.
We like tennis. So we our interest started there.
There.
And I was the coach of Paul at that time. And later on, when an opportunity arose, I was elected chairman of the Kenya Lawn Tennis Association.
Yeah.
A post I had till I became an MP, and I could not continue.
Yeah. So it runs in the blood as well. Are you a proud father?
I'm very proud of Paul and my children, because my two girls were at the top tennis players in the country. Paul, among the boys or the men, was the top tennis player in the country. Not only that, but internationally, Paul reached the top 100 in the ATP ranking. And that has not been attained by any African up to today. So you should try to get Paul to tell you about tennis.
We're still, but my tennis wishes all the best with that. We are still trying to get a hold
tennis,
of him.
My tennis days were ended by me being elected Member of Parliament for Kwanza in 1988.
Talk to us about that.
I had to relinquish chairmanship of the Tennis Loan Association.
All right. So we go into politics. This is in 1988, and you get elected as Member of Parliament for Kwanza Constituency. Let me take you a little bit back when you were making that decision.
Yeah.
What was your vision like? When I go into politics as Noah Wekesa, why am I going into this?
I had no plan for going into politics. But because I was in practice here for about 6-7 years, people knew me in Trans Nzoia. So in 1980, 2007, the cabinet minister, the late Nyamweya, James Nyamweya, he was the chairman of the Electoral Boundary Commission. And we had worked together in Kisii. I'd been in Kisii and I'd met him. So he came here to address leaders about a possibility of creating a constituency. And Kwanza was identified. So I was the first member. Nilikuwa mbunge wa Kwanza. So that. But before that, in 1983, when I was still working in Nairobi, people had wanted me to stand for elections in 1983 against, at that time we had two parliamentary positions here, Kitale West and Kitale East. Kitale East was Muliro, Kitale West was Wamalwa Kijana. So in 1983 I tried my chance, but I came number two. But when it came to 1988, we had a constituency called Kwanza, and I opted to go to Kwanza.
All right.
And of course, I won that in 1988.
What is it that the people of your constituency, Kwanza, and the entire Trans Nzoia County are going to say that this has Dr. Noah Wekesa written all over it?
Humility and respecting people of all grades. Before I joined politics, I saw myself as an educated person, somebody with a degree, what. But politics taught me that people are important, that people of any grade are important. So when I was in politics, I learned to be to recognize the importance of whoever I was talking to. It has been an experience, and I think I learned it from Wamalwa Kijana. Wamalwa Kijana would sit with anybody, greet anybody, eat with anybody, and I looked at this, I said, this is what I want to be. And the reason I was elected four times in Kwanza is being humble, listen to people, don't just talk. Also listen to what people are saying. And it doesn't matter what type of person is talking to you. I remember in Kitale here, there was an old man. He never wore shoes in his life. He asked me one day, he said, Wekesa, I hear you want to stand for elections. If you want to stand for election in Trans Nzoia, you must respect Masinde Muliro, and you should not abuse other leaders. That man is still alive today, and I respect him because he taught me a lot. And I came to realize the importance of listening to other people, accommodating to what they are saying, regardless of their standing in society.
You know, I can sit here the whole day and have a conversation with you because your journey is just long enough.
Yeah.
Long enough to the extent that you're now writing a book about
yes.
it.
Yes.
And it's the contents of this book, we cannot sit in one session and complete it. This is just a scratch of the surface. A lot more comes in the life of this gentleman I have been talking to tonight on Legends Edition, former Member of Parliament for Kwanza Constituency. You've heard how he has been pivotal in shaping the history of this particular country, politically speaking. Thank you so much for watching the Legends Edition tonight. If you want to know more about him, his book is just about to come out. So look forward to that. My name is Serfine Achieng Ouma. Thank you and have a good night.
story of Dr. Noah Wekesa, the first African veterinarian to have a private surgery in Nairobi. He is the first MP for Kwanza Constituency and is a former cabinet minister, as told to Serfine Achieng Ouma. A true living legend of Kenya. And as we celebrate Dr. Noah Wekesa, we celebrate Serfine Achieng Ouma, who won two awards at the Journalists for Human Rights Awards last night. The overall award and the TV award for her story, The Silent Pandemic. And that's all from our newsroom. Join us next week at 9 p.m. for the Legends Edition, only on KBC Channel 1. Our sign language interpreter for tonight's edition was Byron Abudi. I'm Fayaz Qureshi. Have a good night.
Yours was the face I saw above my cradle, the only mother I've ever known.
But my feet are set upon a road that I must follow.
I will teach thee.
Man shall be ruled by law, not by the will of other men.
Slaves are mine.
Let my people go.
My name is Muhammad Ahmed Muhammad, the CEO of Kenya Deposit Insurance Corporation, popularly known as KDIC. The corporation recently increased the protected sum from the previous 100,000 shillings to 500,000 shillings per account. This is the highest in sub-Saharan Africa. In effect, the corporation now covers 99% of the depositors in the unlikely event of a closure of a bank. So KDIC encourages the depositors to continue doing business with our banks that are strong and resilient.
Be sure, check out for a KDIC sticker in your banking hall. KDIC, protecting your deposits.
This Sunday, watch the Jamhuri Day celebrations live on KBC Channel 1 on the 12th of December 2021, presided over by President Uhuru Kenyatta at the Uhuru Gardens.